Well, hi, everyone, and greetings from Northern Michigan. This is Bob the Science Guy, and welcome to another episode of Northwood Scientist. Many of us have globes at home that have this figure eight pattern in the eastern Pacific Ocean. This is called a solar analemma, and it traces the path of the sun throughout the year. In this episode, we're going to see how the analemma is constructed. We're going to see photographs of it, and we're going to learn how to use it to make predictions on our Earth. Well, let's start off with a situation where the Earth is in a perfectly circular orbit at a steady speed around the sun. The other thing that we have to assume is that there is no axial tilt. So every day the sun would rise directly east on the equator, it would go straight up overhead at noon, and then it would set directly west, again following the equator all the way around the Earth. Now, if we set up a camera pointing straight up and took a single picture every day at 12 noon, the sun would be directly overhead, and if we combined all those photographs over the course of a year, we would have a single dot that would represent the sun at 90 degrees above our heads. Now let's take that same situation and change it a little bit. Let's put an axial tilt into the Earth. It'll continue along at a steady rate in a perfectly circular orbit, but say we're tilting 23.5 degrees. So say the sun reached its furthest point to the north in June. It would be 23.5 degrees off the vertical towards the north in June. It would then move back and be directly over the equator and continue to move southward until it went 23.5 degrees off the vertical towards the south in December. In June, that would be called a solstice, and December would be called a solstice. And the two times that it went directly over the equator would be called an equinox. Now, if we again put a camera pointed straight up and snapped a picture every day at 12 noon for 365 days, what we would see would be a continuous line of suns going from the June solstice, 23.5 degrees north of the vertical, down through the vertical, and to the south solstice in December, 23.5 degrees off the vertical towards the south. Now, let's see this on the actual analemma on the globe. If you look on this analemma, you will see a black and yellow vertical line that extends from the Tropic of Capricorn in the south through the equator up to the Tropic of Cancer in the north. This is the path of the sun if the Earth was in a perfectly circular orbit and didn't change orbital speeds. The sun would simply go back and forth on that line throughout the year, having a June solstice, a December solstice, and passing across the equator twice. But as it turns out, the sun does not follow that black and yellow line. It follows this figure eight pattern. Now, why is that? The answer is because the Earth's orbit around the sun is not perfectly circular. It's elliptical. Let me show you what I mean. The Earth's orbit is elliptical, and at the December 21st solstice, it is closest to the sun, and at the June 21st solstice, it is furthest away from the sun. These positions are called perihelion for December and aphelion for June. This is important due to Kepler's second law, because at perihelion, where the sun is closest to the Earth is moving faster in its orbit than it is at aphelion, when the sun is furthest away from the Earth. And this change in orbital speed is seen in the analemma. To understand why this is, we need to understand the difference between apparent solar noon and mean solar noon. First thing I want to talk about is something called local solar noon, or apparent solar noon. If you are on a location on the Earth and you look up, when the sun is at its highest point during the day, it will be directly due south of you, and that will be called apparent local solar noon. Now, if you take the number of hours, minutes, and seconds from one local solar noon to the next day at local solar noon and average that out over a year, you get something called mean solar noon. Now, what would that look like on the analemma? Now, imagine that we're on an island in the eastern Pacific here that is on that black and yellow line. Every time that black and yellow line passed overhead of our little island, our watch would read 12 noon. But because of the changes in the velocity of the Earth in its orbit, actual or apparent solar noon may arrive a little bit early, or it may arrive a little bit late, by up to 15 minutes either way. And that is why the solar analemma is this figure 8 shape. Now let's go ahead and look at an actual example of this. In the northern hemisphere, the sun is at its highest in the sky during the summer solstice, which is June 21st. Now on December 21st, 6 months later, the sun is at the lowest point in the sky at the same hour of day, again to the south. Now, if you look at the analemma, there's a couple of things that you can tell from it right off the bat. First of all, the central portion of the analemma, which is the middle horizontal line that you see there, is a certain distance above the horizon. Now, that distance above the horizon is 90 degrees minus the latitude of the observer. So if you're at 60 degrees north latitude, the center of that analemma will be 30 degrees above the south horizon. If you look at the two lines on either side of the analemma, top and bottom, you will notice that they vary from that central line by the same amount. That amount is 23.5 degrees, which is the equivalent of the axial tilt of the Earth. So the entire analemma is approximately 47 degrees from top to bottom. But what about left to right? Now recall that according to mean solar noon, which is the time that we set our watches to, if we plotted that on this analemma, it would form a single vertical line from the bottom of the analemma to the top. However, apparent solar noon changes a little bit due to the differences in the speed of our orbit around the sun. So if you look at this diagram of the analemma and divide it down the middle by a vertical line, if the path of the sun is to the left of that, it is said to be a fast sun, and if the path of the sun is to the right of that, it is said to be a slow sun. This has to do again with our orbital speed, and apparent solar noon arrives a little before or a little after mean solar noon based on that speed. Now, by setting up a camera and taking a picture at the same time every day for an entire year, we can actually photograph a solar analemma. As a matter of fact, this gentleman set a camera up and took a picture every minute for 10 hours a day for an entire year, over 180,000 exposures. The result is this remarkable movie of the actual analemma moving across the sky hour by hour. It was done using a digital camera and a solar filter, taking one exposure every 60 seconds. If you notice the twinkling in the analemma, that's because clouds were passing in front of the sun on that day at that particular hour. The original background of this photograph was black due to the solar filter, so the lights were superimposed over a shot of the same area of the sky on a good day, so that you could just watch the thing go right across the sky. It really was quite the labor of love, and I've got a link to the original video in the description of this one. Now, a couple of things that you should know on this photograph. This was taken in the northern hemisphere. You notice that the small loop of the analemma is at the top and the large loop is at the bottom. Let's see if we can have a look at other locations on Earth and see if we can explain why the analemma looks the way that it does. Now recall that the path of the sun goes between the Tropic of Capricorn and the Tropic of Cancer, forming this figure 8 pattern with the small loop towards the north and the large loop towards the south. If you were on the equator, looking towards the west at the setting sun, the analemma would look like it's on its side, again, with the small loop towards your right or north and the large loop towards your left or south. But what about this analemma, where the large loop is above the small loop? Where would this have to be? If you answered in the southern hemisphere, perhaps around Sydney, Australia, you would be correct. This is what the analemma looks like in the southern hemisphere. It's the exact opposite of what we see in the northern hemisphere. Now this is an interesting analemma. Is that the large loop or the small loop? It's clearly the large loop. The other thing that we have to ask ourselves is, where's the bottom half of the analemma, the one that would contain the small loop? It's not visible. The horizon blocks it out. So where on Earth was this taken? If you answered the South Pole or actually between the South Pole and the Antarctic Circle. You would be correct. As an exercise, what would the Analemma look like above the Arctic Circle in the north? We would only see half of it, and we would see the half that had the small loop in it. Now, this is a very interesting analemma. Where on Earth would we see this analemma, this bean-shaped analemma? Well, the answer is we wouldn't see it on Earth. This is the analemma from Mars. Every planet has got a different analemma based on its axial tilt and the eccentricity of its orbit. Now, one thing that I want to close with is, due to photographic techniques, the first analemma was photographed in 1978. That does not mean that we did not know what the analemma was. For example, this is a Swedish king's tomb from the Dark Ages. These are called ship stones because they appeared to be laid out in the pattern of a ship. However, having a look at an aerial photograph of the same area, you see that there is a burial mound in the southwest, and then these stones stretch out in a familiar pattern. Now, if you put a marker or a stick in that burial mound and catch the shadow from the evening sun, you might have yourself a little calendar. Now, there really are some interesting things that you can do with a diagram of an analemma. You can tell the declination of the sun. You can find the earliest and the latest sunrise of the year. We'll probably do another episode on this in the future, but I wanted to give a very basic overview of what an analemma was and how to use it. So I hope that you've enjoyed it. This is Bob the Science Guy signing out from Northern Michigan. Remember to go down and hit that little like and subscribe button in the right lower corner. And I'll be seeing you again soon. Thanks for stopping by.